Testament. How many of you have been blessed because of their speaking? See, that's right. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Parents, thank you so much for loving them, for having them available for this divine appointment. Truly, you guys blessed? Okay, so that's the most important thing. They have been blessed, we have been blessed, we praise the Lord. Thank you so much, and for the rest of the participants, please just stand wherever you are. You participate in prayer, praise time, whatever it is during the week. Can you stand? Come on. Stand. You participate? Okay. Yes. Thank you so much for your participation. Thank you very much.
Happy Sabbath, Church. Psalm 136, verse 1 says, give thanks to the Lord, for He is good. His steadfast love endures forever. And isn't it great that we have God who will eternally love us? And now as we begin our praise and worship, let us all lift up our voices as we celebrate God, as we celebrate His unending goodness and His love.
Serve us humble.
children, please stand up as we continue with our church of worship. We're singing forever. Good, he is above all things.
Unspeakable patience. really did only make rules for its best good. Kind of like when your parents tell you not to do something that you want to do, they just do it to keep you safe. He was never an arbitrary, bossy, or angry God. He didn't create any commandments that weren't needed to keep his children safe. One of these days, the end of all the situations will come. Jesus will come back, and instead of the gentle carpenter from Galilee, he'll be an unspeakably powerful ruler, the Most High God. So, what should we think about this? In Martin Luther's time, not to be confused with Martin Luther King Jr., because that's what I thought at first. It's actually this guy here. People thought that God was angry and vengeful, not only making up rules just because he wanted to, but also always watching for every little breaking of one of those rules. They were afraid of the great day of judgment. The whole reason why Martin Luther tried so hard to be sinless and punish himself if he sinned was because he thought that if he didn't, he would have to spend a long time being punished much worse in purgatory before he could go to heaven, if he made it to heaven at all. More than anything, he dreaded the day when God had come to judge the wicked, because he was pretty sure he was wicked. When Luther learned about grace and realized what a loving God we have, everything changed. He learned that yes, he was wicked, but that Jesus came to save him while he was a sinner, that salvation was entirely by the grace of God, a gift, and that only Jesus and the Holy Spirit had the power to make Luther loving instead of wicked. In fact, when he was worrying about his own sins all the time, he had no energy left to be loving anyone else. When Luther learned all this, he stopped being afraid of the end of time. He knew that judgment fit right in with all the other teachings, that judgment was only the end of what God had begun, and was only to be feared if one had determinedly said no to God. He even called the last day, okay, so I don't speak German, so I'm sorry if that messes up, but it's Lieber Jüngstertag, which literally translates to beloved youngest day. He's calling the very last day the first as well, the first day of a time in which all things will be new. And talking about that makes me think about graduation. Even though sometimes I don't look like it, I'm a senior in high school, and yeah, some people think I'm a freshman. But I'm going to graduate about 3 months from now, and it's made me realize that this part of my life, walking through the halls of my high school and seeing my friends, is ending, and that a new one is starting where I'm in college and I don't know anyone. And while it is scary and exciting to finally be finishing high school and leaving, I'm also sad because I may not see the friends that I have made over the past 4 years that I was there. I will miss hanging out with them and just talking to them every day, but we're all going to be going on our separate ways out of state, out of San Diego. And Jesus felt the same way after the Last Supper with his disciples. He knew his time with them was coming to an end, and he still understood so little of what he had been trying to teach them. In the time it took for them to walk from the upper room where they had eaten Passover to the Garden of Gethsemane, where little did they know, Jesus would face his greatest battle. He tried to teach them all the things he still wanted most for them to understand. One of those things was that he would come back. In John 14, verses 1 and 3, it says, "Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. My Father's house has many rooms. If that were not so, would I have told you that I am going there to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and I take you to be with me that you may also be where I am." We are all familiar with these verses. Jesus is saying, don't be afraid. You can trust both my Father and me. His house has room enough for all who will come. I'm going to make your place ready, and I will come again and take you there with me. When the world begins to get us down, when things look so wrong, it's hard to believe that anything will ever change, we can comfort ourselves by reading these words again. They're not something a disciple said about Jesus. They're not words by Peter or Paul or James to encourage us. Jesus himself said these words. Jesus, you can trust this promise. Of course, it's also encouraging to read what Jesus' followers said about the subject. So let's look at 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 and 9. It says, "But do not forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance." Here, Peter reminds us that with God, 1,000 years passes like a day, and yet he can do as much as we could in 1,000 years. Listening to each prayer, helping millions of his followers, calling millions of sinners. He also reminds us that God is not slow, he's patient. And that God does not want one single person to be lost. When it seems as if Jesus is taking too long and we'll never get here, read these verses again. Then ask what you might do to help others come to repentance. Now going to 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16-18, it says, "For the Lord himself will come down from heaven with a loud command, with the voice of the archangel, and with the trumpet call of God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. After that, we who are still alive and are left will be caught up together with them in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air. And so we will be with the Lord forever. Therefore, encourage one another with these words." In the verses right before this, it's clear that Paul is encouraging people who have lost loved ones in death. Have you lost people you loved? Sorry. For me, almost a year ago, my grandma passed away. And I still remember that my mom had texted me in the middle of class saying that, telling me what had happened. And I just remember sitting there and like trying to process what had happened and then trying not to cry in the middle of class. And because for me, this was the first time that someone I was closer to, someone who I have a lot of fond memories of, passed away. And so it was kind of hard for me to like deal with that. And of course, when our family got together, there were a lot of tears, but we knew that we were able to see her again in heaven. So that comforted us. Can you imagine how much harder it would be if you didn't know if you would ever see those faces again? Some of the people reading Paul's letter were not sure. Perhaps sometimes you're not sure. When that happens, read these words again. Jesus' coming is a big event. It's loud, with a loud trumpet and the voice of the archangel. The dead in Christ will rise up to meet him in the air. Then those who are still alive on earth are caught up together with them in the clouds. We will be with God forever. Forever. It's exciting to think about. And we really have no idea at all what it would be like. I remember when I was little in Sabbath school, all the aunties would be teaching us the lesson and they'd be talking to us about how heaven explained what they thought it would look like. And from that, I always thought that heaven would be like this huge place with like a castle, mansion, palace kind of thing made out of like solid gold, and it'd just be sitting in the clouds, and then everyone would have like rock star bodies, and be able to like lift anything and do backflips, and also for some reason I thought that we would be riding lions as a form of transportation, because my mom told me that like any dangerous animals would be like they won't hurt us, so that's my first thought, and then we'd also just be jumping through the clouds because but so now the question is, how do we get there? Let's go back to John 14. If we continue the conversation Jesus was having with his disciples, we'll find the answer to this question. In verses 4 to 6, it says, "You know the way to the place where I am going," Thomas said to him. "Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered. Jesus answered, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." So the question that Thomas asked, have you ever asked that question before? I had a similar question when I was little. You see, my mom will deny this, but she is like the worst at directions. Like this morning, she almost missed the turn to the church. And I was like, "Mom, where are you going? We have to go to church. I'm speaking today." I don't know where she's going. But all the way back in 2005, we had gotten our Honda Accord. And so it was my brother and my dad in the new car. And it was my mom and I in our Odyssey. And as we were driving, my mom had gotten lost as we were driving, and in the back I was like, "Mom, where are we going? Why aren't we going home? Why is it taking so long?" And when my mom had told me that we got lost, I started bawling. Like, I was crying my eyes out, I was screaming, because I thought that we were never going to get home, and then we would run out of gas, and we'd be stranded in the middle of the freeway, in the middle and in the middle of the night. So I was terrified. And I remember my mom kept telling me to pray. But as a five-year-old, at that point, like, I was too scared about the thought of just never coming home again to be able to do so. But my mom, as she was driving, she was praying, and she was asking God for guidance to help us get home. And in the end, we did. Amen. Love you, Mom. What is Jesus' answer to Thomas' question? He says, "I am the way." Those first two words, you know, are God's family name. In Hebrew, it's often pronounced as Yahweh or Jehovah, and it means "I am" or "I am that I am." In this case, Jesus is answering Thomas' question by saying, "I know how to get there. Just follow me." In one way, Jesus is the one we follow. We want to follow his path and live as he lived. In another way, he is the path. Remember, we found in Hebrews that his body was the curtain that was torn so that we could enter the presence of God. If you read the next several verses, you will see Jesus trying to explain that everything he did in his life on earth was done because he lived in the Father and the Father lived in him. It's not a thing we humans can really understand, but it is a reality made possible through the powerful presence of the Holy Spirit in our lives. We can just accept it and ask for it to be true for us. Thus, eventually, when Jesus comes to take us home, it will be an eternal extension to the eternal kind of life that we will have started to live in him in the here and now. If we live in Jesus, and Jesus lives in us every day of our lives, then when he goes home, he'll take us with him. Adventists often talk of being ready for Jesus to come. Sometimes this leads to the same kind of anxiety that Luther and the people of his day were experiencing. That if I'm not doing enough, what if I'm not doing enough or not doing it right? What if I'm sinning and don't even know it? What if I do something wrong and right then I die or Jesus comes? We'll never know if we're good enough. And if you feel as if you're not ready for Jesus to come, then ask yourselves these questions. Do you believe Jesus died for you and wants to save you? Do you believe he loves you? Do you love him back? Have you asked him to live in your heart? And are you ready to listen to him every day? If you answered yes to any of these questions, then you're ready, period. The last day is not something to fear and dread. Even the Old Testament in Daniel 7:22 it says that God will judge in favor of the holy people of Minosha. That's you, and that's me. If we have said yes to God and are allowing Him to live in us and work out His will, He will judge in our favor. Martin Luther would have liked the book Illinois wrote 300 years before after his time, The Great Controversy. The very last passage of that book is one of the most beloved of all of Mrs. White's writings. It says, "The great controversy is ended. Sin and sinners are no more. The entire universe is clean. One pulse of harmony and gladness beats through the vast creation. From Him who created all, flow life and light and gladness throughout the realms of illimitable space. From the minutest atom to the greatest world, all things, animate and inanimate, in their unshadowed beauty and perfect joy, declare that God is love." God is love. That's the whole point. That's why every principle that Luther discovered, every principle that we have looked at during this week of prayer is all about. Because God is love, He has given us His Holy Bible, and we trust it more than anything humans have ever said. Because God is love, He sent His Son to save us, for no other reason than because He loves us that much. Because God is love, Jesus can be the center of our lives, and prayer can be the fuel that keeps us burning brightly in the dark world. Because God is love, He calls all His followers to be priests of His grace, sharing the joyful news with everyone. Because God is love, He gave us a beautiful ceremony we call communion, and it can help us to develop a true community of love. Because God is love, He forgives every sin we confess without scolding or punishing, though there's so many consequences of our sin, but that's loving too. And because God is love, we choose to be baptized into His body and live in unity with His Spirit in our hearts, leading us into all truth. And because God is love, He will never leave us here. Jesus is coming to get us and take us home forever. And that, as Luther learned, is not something to fear. It is something to look forward to with great joy.
Amen. Amen. Amen.